So a warm welcome and hello everyone. Warm welcome to all of you in this yet another webinar from Parul Institute of Public Health. Special mention to our speaker today, Dr. Harsha, who kindly agreed for his time for this webinar. So before I hand over this session to our speaker, Dr. Harsha, let me give you all a brief introduction about our speaker. So Dr. Harsh is a public health expert, health policy making as well. His MBBS from Jamnagar Medical College, Impisha Medical College Department from Impisha Medical. Also, epidemiology fellowship at CMC Vellore. Government of Gujarat Health and Family Welfare Division, and he has been an instrumental in providing improved bottom-to-up planning process and providing technical and procedural support to leverage the NHM flexibility for accelerated outcomes. Before this, he has served as UNICEF State Consultant under RMNCH Plus A Planning and Monitoring. And he has also been involved actively in providing guest lectures in various academic institutes, and he has some more than 15 research publications in peer-reviewed indexed national and international journals. Apart from this vast academic portfolio which he has, Dr. Harsh is also an avid photographer, and he is an active sportsman by heart, and he is a national player for of table tennis and cricket player for various doctors clubs and organizations. So we have a very vibrant personality with us today. We are graced by his presence today, and we warmly welcome you, sir, in this particular session.
Thank you.
This to you, sir. Harsh, sir.
Thank you, Vaibhav. Very good morning to all of you. Let's talk about the business today. First of all, the national health programs under the NHM umbrella. Over the period, there are various national health programs included through the various schemes, and ultimately that programs had taken the wide spectrum with the financial part and for the physical part also. So we will talk about the what is the NHM, then what are the interventions across the NHM, because most of the programs are now covered under the NHM. Initially, those are the verticals program and various disease control programs, non-communicable disease control programs, but now they are all under the NHM. And over the expansions, what we see under the national health policy, that we need to increase our health expenditure, public health expenditure on the health. So we would be seeing more of the health programs or more of the health funding under the NHM over the year. So we will talk about those health interventions across the national health mission. Then we will be taking to convert to translate those programs into the financial part. So this will be a 45 minutes lecture, and I expect that after the 45 minutes we would be having some of the question answer. Let's start with the basic concepts. Initially, the national health programs has not reshaped in a way such as it is now. So what I gather on the during my academics year, during my implementation year, during my planning years, that the most of the policy makers seeking the actual meaning of what is health. There are various meanings of health in the context of academics, in the context of implementation, in the context of philosophical part also, in the context of a normal citizen. But for our perspectives, many of the students are attending this webinar. So for the many of the students, they used to have their different context of the public health. What is public health actually? Most of the interventions across the public health are integrated with other departments also. So the public health I'm searching, and I hope I learn over the periods of my years as a public health expertise. So begin with what initial concept was to provide care to the vulnerable population. So what I gather for me, the public health starts with the vaccinations of smallpox, but initially the actual public health started with the vaccination of cowpox. So in 1892, when the Edward Jenner that identified that we should move with the public health perspectives, then that was the era of starting of public health. But for our context, for our academic context, for our programmatic context, the programs have been defined in a very structured manner. Starts from the 1992 when we had CSSM, Child Surveillance Safe Mother Home. Then the most path-breaking intervention came with the RCH1, which is 95 to 97. In those periods, we would be experienced that PPI, pulse polio immunization, started with the 95. Then DOTS under the tuberculosis. Also, we are having the, some kind of interventions up to the field level for the RTI and STIs. Then started with the 2005, the reshaping of RCH1 has had provided us certain experiences that we need to develop our infrastructure, start from the money, men and materials. So the inception of NHM has been main pillars that the experience from the previous programs had defined that we need to establish a certain health system with some kind of infrastructure. That infrastructure needs to have man, material and money that can help the programs to implement. So initially NRHM was only the financial aspect, that the state can have those interventions that supported by the central government. And most of the schemes, if you read the documents, that initially only GSY was the leading component of NRHM, and over the period in the 2008 and 2010, the ASHA was introduced, which is groundbreaking health interventions across the India, across the world also. In 2011 and 2012, we were moving more towards the completion or achievement of Millennium Development Goals, and in those contexts, we did identify that the urban part is also to be included in the NHM. So NUHM was created, and those part has been clubbed with NRHM, and now that defined as NHM. In 2011 and 12, also the most of the vertical programs are also included into the umbrella of NHM. So earlier the NUBDCP was vertical and they were funded by the different agencies. Now all the national health programs, those who were vertical and had critical impact on health, now included under the NHM. NUHM mostly provides the infrastructure of urban areas, and the programs to be implemented are across the dimension of NHM. In 2013, the world had witnessed that we need to achieve Millennium Development Goals up to 2015, and we are quite behind to achieve those goals. So call to action was identified. High priority districts were included into the health interventions, then the high priority district should get all the priority across the nations. And in India, 184 districts were identified for the RMMCH plus A interventions, and more of the vaccines were introduced in 2012 to 2014. If you remember that the pentavalent vaccines, open well policy were the products of those call to actions interventions. And still in 2017-18, we were moving with the Niti Aayog. So Niti Aayog is guiding now the all the health policy, all the health interventions across the nation. And those interventions should have main component of universal health coverage. What we are saying that universal health coverage is Ayushman Bharat in India. So PM has introduced those schemes that should cover a most vulnerable population in a financial support way. So in 2017-18, we have deep penetration of Ayushman Bharat in terms of PMJY, Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, where we are giving 5 lakhs cover to the BPL population, and also we are opening health and wellness centers up to the all sub-centers. So in Gujarat, there are 10,000 more sub-centers across the districts. So we are now moving with the all sub-centers to be identified as the health and wellness centers. Then those health and wellness centers do have some kind of man, material and machines that can support the all the health interventions. Now, I would like to discuss about what is the NHM. It was started with the 12th April 2005. It was launched with the more profound vision of to achieve Millennium Development Goals, and that carried back experiences of RCH1 and CSSM programs, also the vertical programs to be including later on. But in 2005, the main agenda of NHM to provide a financial support to the states. And those experience with carried with the certain understanding that we need to identify a urban part also, and that should be prioritized also. And NUHM was created, the NUHM and NRHM clubbed on 1st May 2013. That encompasses National Health Mission. From this beginning, the vision of NHM was to attain a universal access to equitable, affordable and quality healthcare services to the people's need with the, and it also some kind of vision to have effective intersectoral convergent actions by keeping mind of social determinants of health. So these are the broad visions of NHM that we need to cover all the aspects of health in a most comprehensive way. These are the objectives. I would like to discuss that, but most of the times that they reduce disease burden, reduce mortality, and also eradicate those diseases. Those are the words of the extinction. Those are the words on the creating less impact on people's health. So those diseases to be eradicated, whether it is the leprosy also, whether it is now we do have elimination program of TB, anti-TB. These are the programs to be impact of morbidity. Basically, NHM covers the funding part and it also covers the programs part. So to run each program, we need some kind of financial aspects. If you do remember that the ASHA is not a social activity. So for the various activities, so those incentives to be included into the NHM. So each program has its own management, and NHM creates those flexibility So National Health Mission is funding that then can seventy-five to 25% is share. 75% from the government of India and 25% from the state government, but 60% to 40%. Most of the times that we need to prepare some one of the PIP, that the project implementation plan that covers the our next year achievement and next year the targets, and that those targets to be translated into the financial part through the PIP. We will discuss those PIP part in later on. We will discuss this in the later on for the financial aspects of NHS. Yeah. Now NHM has been divided into four parts. Starts with the RMN CH plus A, which is the first one. Second part is as a NUHM. Third part is a communicable diseases. And fourth part is non-communicable diseases. So most of the students, most of the people are aware about the RMN CH plus A activity that covers maternal and child health, family planning, adolescent health, immunization, RBSK. Those are the most critical programs. ASHA has been covered under the RMN CH plus A and the health system strengthening part. Urban structures, infrastructures, human resource, and funds to the urban slums. What that covers under the communicable diseases, those are the RNTCP that now has been named as NTEP. We do have a national leprosy. We do have a system of IDSP that controls, that covers the epidemic aspects of diseases that when raised up to the alert. New control of hepatitis, national hepatitis control program. Another part is, fourth part is non-communicable disease control program. Recently we had seen the rise of the non-communicable diseases as a diabetes, cardiac diseases, and also the cancers. So newer programs have been included into the this flexi pool as a non-communicable disease control program. Those programs are NPCDCS, that the National Program for Control of Diabetes, Cancer, Cardiac Diseases, and Stroke. We do have a mental health program under the NCD. We do have a tobacco control program, and also now focusing towards the elderly care. So we do have that health interventions under the NCD. So these are the programs. Most of the times at a PHC level, we used to monitor 18 to 19 health programs, and at the state level approximately there are 36 to 14 national health programs to be monitored by the each health divisions. And earlier, as my role of senior consultant, I used to prepare a comprehensive plan for all the national health programs, and we need to submit to the Government of India for the approval of our budget and PIP. These are the major programs. Start from the RMN CH plus A to the disease control program to the non-communicable disease control program. At the national level, the NHM National Health Mission has some kind of institution set up that it, most of the health systeming part has been covered by the National Health Mission, and these are the institutional structures which do have their steering committee and governing body committees. These are the chairpersons, the convener, co-convener. Most of the health systems and health policies are governed through this institutional setup, if you come across that we need to implement this program, we need to introduce this kind of vaccines, that those mission steering groups and empower committee groups to be taken into the loop, and we need to get those approvals from the mission steering groups. I'll talk about the times that we do have some kind of institutional setup. The state health mission that comprises the governing body committees and also the executive body committees. Most of the times, governing body committees are headed by the chief secretaries and principal secretaries, and the executive committee bodies are headed by the secretaries and all the additional directors of the health department. So at the state level, we do have that kind of vision set up, and at the district level, the district health society is headed by the DDO or collector. Then we do have PRI involvement through the Rogi Kalyan Samiti, and at the village level, we do have village health and sanitation committee. One second. And at the urban level, we do have a PRI involvement through the Mahila Arogya Samiti, where we used to, where we need to involve urban local bodies across the all Mahila Arogya Samiti. That is under the UPHC and UCHCs. Earlier I told that the Niti Aayog is all headed by the big public health expert across the nation. So they do have some kind of policy level network across the India, and they are monitoring our health indicators through independent body and through the our reporting systems. They used to give us a ranking that each state need to achieve certain kind of scores, and Gujarat is heading at the fourth rank in year 2017 and 2018. 23 indicators are included in Niti Aayog health index, and each states are reviewed every 2 months by those index. So each state has to achieve some kind of target set by the Niti Aayog, and at the state level, every week and every month, the monitoring committee provides the data that each program has to work on these aspects in these districts, and programs used to drill down those gaps up to the taluka level, and they work on the indicators. This slide is only for the information that the students can get the idea that what are the most leading cause of Delhi's in Gujarat, and these are taken from the very good report, namely status of India states. Those students who are interested to understand the disease burden across the nation, across the states, and they should read this document for the informations. And most of the health dimensions are reshaping by the disease burden across the nation. So earlier we used to have most of the deaths from the infectious disease, and now the non-communicable diseases are taking toll on the people morbidity, community morbidity. Now let's talk about the health interventions. We will finish it by the 20 minutes. There are many health interventions one has to read and one has to see in the health department. So I request most of the students to go in the field to understand those health programs. If you meet the ASHA, then what is her role into the program implementation? That needs to be understood. Because if you go by the books, that doesn't give you total picture of what is the health interventions and what are the health interventions that reduces the morbidity and mortality. So raise the questions, go in the field, understand the health projects, health interventions, meet the frontline workers, understand their role, understand their activities, and link it them with the health indicators. Most of the health programs are designed, health interventions are designed based at their levels. So if I want to do some kind of interventions across the state, then I need to identify my target audience. What will be my target audience? So is it the community? Is it the facility? Or is it the household-based activity that I need to identify? Then other aspects to be tagged along with the health interventions. Whenever the non-communicable diseases were introduced earlier in 2014 and 15, the guidelines demarcated that states should plan, a state should design their own interventions within these programs of broad objectives. So, one should have a better picture of their target audience, and that way one can design the health interventions, one can understand the health interventions, and these are the five pillars that to be understood of each health interventions. I would be not going into the details of each intervention, each their aspects in details, but we will summarize some of the interventions in a short way. If you know, the Gujarat do have a larger coastal area, larger the border areas across the four states, also the union territories at the bottom. We do have a tribal northeast belt, we do have a desert development plan across the Kutch and Banaskantha and Patan. We do have a coastal part, higher side at the 1600 kilometers. So we do have a diverse population, we do have a diverse geography within the states, and there are 33 districts, 8 corporations, 250 talukas across the Gujarat. That the NHM is covering across the state with health interventions. Of health system strengthening of health interventions. Each health interventions do have these 18 components within their aspects. So we need to tag each health interventions. Just say that the GSSK Janani Shishu Suraksha Yojana, that do have a target audience of community. So number two here is the service delivery of community based interventions, and that do have requirements of funds, so that to be tagged along with the financial aspect. We do have intervention based on life cycle approach, starts from the pre-pregnancy to the pregnancy to the delivery to the postnatal care to the neonatal care. So that all the health interventions are designed that the person should get life cycle approach, starts from the birth to the death. These are the pictorial aspects of umbrella cover for continuum of care, that patient should get care starts from the home to the facility and facility to the home. So most of the schemes are designed like that way, and the monitoring part also covers the each aspects of the life cycle approach. Start with the programs. These are the major indicators. Recently we had achieved 75 MMR for 1 lakh live births, and our goal is to reach 50 in the next years. We do have infant death infant mortality rate at 28 per 1,000 live births. So our goal is to achieve 10. Same way immunization we are leading across the nation. Same way in the nutrition, we need to work on the severe acute malnutrition part. Anemic mother is high concern across the nation, that if you read the NFHS data, NFHS 4 data, that all the states have larger impact of anemia on the pregnant mothers, on the children part. And many states goes reversal with the higher percentage of anemic mothers. So that is a quite concern in India. And if you read the recent reports on the nutrition, that Bangladesh and Pakistan are doing quite better than India in hunger index. These are the indicators that RNTCP now has been defined as NTAP. So each state has to achieve TB notification rate more than 95%, and our goal is to reach TB free Gujarat. Mostly TB free means to eliminate the cases up to substantial level up to 2022. Same way, our goal for the MEBDCP, our goal for NLEP, our goal for NCD, our goal for mental health, and our goal for ophthalmic control program, ophthalmic cataract control program. These are the data showing that our achievements over the period. State had achieved 75 MMR, starts from the 172 from 2001 to 2003. We had achieved IMR of 28, started from 44 to 28. And for the immunization, based on the recent reports, we are having the 98% of coverage. There are various interventions across the maternal health component at the community level and at the facility. When I see the interventions, I divide them as per their target audience, and most of the times based on the community level and facility level, I need to monitor those programs. So at the community level, there are various programs, start from the Mamta Abhiyan, also the Janni Suraksha Yojana, also the Janni Shishu Raksha Karyakram. Those are the leading programs at the community level. And at the facility level, we do have obstetric ICU, we do have CMOC services, we do have blood storage unit and GERD bank units. And also recently, the quality aspects of maternal health are included into the Lakshya schemes. So Lakshya are the quality parameters to provide maternal health services at the facility level. These are the child health interventions across the family, across the sub-center level, and across the health facility levels. Most of the community programs are assisted by ASHA, assisted by the frontline health workers, which includes FHW and MPHW. So these programs are for your information only. And if you visit the field, just go through each programs and understand their intricacy, understand their dimension, understand their implementation part in depth, so you can have ideas about the national health programs in detail. Presently in Gujarat, we are providing the vaccines for the 10 diseases. Now rotavirus are also the part of UIP, universal immunization programs, and the components of RI, namely capacity building for various interventions, vaccines to be provided with the cold, effective cold chain, surveillance of vaccine preventable diseases. That if you heard that recently there were deaths due to diphtheria, deaths due to measles happened in Gujarat and other states also. We had eradicated polio since 2010-2011 and in India 2013. But we need to be vigilant for the AFP cases, that is acute flaccid paralyzed cases. There is also a reporting and monitoring mechanism for the adverse event following immunization. If you heard that many times that the death has been occurred after the vaccination. So there is certain guidelines that provides a platform to understand the reason of death. And through those criteria, we take that the deaths happened due to vaccination or not. Each year, 100 to 150 AEFI happens, and let me tell you, the no deaths happens due to a vaccine incomplete. Most of the deaths are incidental. Most of the deaths happen due to the ill health of babies, and most of the intervention or vaccination happen in the right way. So these AEFIs to be reported, that so we can investigate those AEFI in a more complex manner. RK is case for the adolescent health. These are the components, strategic priorities in the RKSK. Nutrition aspects would be seen by the health department also and ICDS department. So they used ICDS department used to give the rations, take off ration homes, and we used to monitor the health parameters and community growth monitoring of each child. So if we find that there are any health problems within the growth of the child or mother, we do have facility aspects in the nutritional interventions. Family planning is critical in the RMNC Plus services. If you see that most of the interventions in 1980 and 1990, they were focusing only on the family planning services, that the sterilization and contraceptives. So still, these are the challenges state is facing. We need to minimize unmet need, and we need to increase a MCP, a couple protection rate, across the Gujarat. So Gujarat has achieved TFR 2.1, but unmet need to be minimized. What I said about the sex ratio, and it is quite a concern, and PCPNDT Act is helping us to fight the challenges at the social level. At the PCPNDT is an act supported through the law, and we do have certain authorities over the private clinicians, private gynecologists to control the sex determination. On the quality part, we do have various schemes of NQS, Lakshya implementation, and Kayakalp. These are the certification to be given for the facilities, and various quality parameters have been included in these quality certifications. If you read that, then most of the hospitals to be have an NABH certification. And in the government, we insist that the facility to be have a NQS certification, Lakshya certification, and Kayakalp certification. These are certification only for the government facilities, not at the private facilities. Private facilities to be have an NABH JCI certification at RBA. These are current strategies of family planning. The RNTCP has shaped in very complex manner, and so did patients. Earlier, we used to see the patients of simple, that they do have only an infection of mycobacterium tuberculosis. But now we are facing the biggest challenge of antimicrobial resistance. So we do have a more number of patients that are resistant with first line of drug treatment of TB. So we do have comorbidities at a concern, that TB patients do have HIV. Those are patients to be hard to track and to be included into our coverage area. And also the MDR-TB, multi-drug resistant TB, is quite a concern nowadays. Recently, outbreak of chikungunya has raised again concern of vector control aspects. So, National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program is handling all vector-borne diseases. So, whether it is malaria, lymphatic filariasis, dengue, and chikungunya, the main objective is to reduce morbidity and mortality across the vector-borne diseases. These are the major goals, these are the targets set by the Government of India for each state. Leprosy. There are 12 districts which do have a high endemicity of leprosy. Dang is one of them, which is 4 tribal districts do not have a burden of other diseases, but communicable diseases. But leprosy is quite prevalent in Dangs and most of the tribal districts. So these 12 high endemic districts are mostly tribal districts. We are able to eradicate leprosy in most of the 20 districts of Gujarat states, but still we are facing challenges of leprosy in tribal blocks. These are the indicators that we used to monitor the leprosy program. Another program is National Program for Control of Blindness and Visual Impairments. This program is provided the support for the cataract operations, the trachoma management, and that do have certain aspects of providing free optical lens, free specs to the children. So I have narrated those activities under the programs. Most of the times we do have cataract surgeries in the government sectors, and also providing financial incentives to NGO sectors for the cataract surgeries. We are providing free of cost the intraocular lens to the all cataract patients who are in the government hospitals that came for cataract surgery. Next phase mein we are planning to expand the eye donation sites, and by the 2022 the state is expecting to have all the districts with eye donation banks. Recently COVID has raised the concern and raised the approach that to be handled very carefully, cautiously, of all communicable diseases, and COVID given us the different dimension of public health, different thoughts on public health, that we need to establish a core health system that can handle all the emergencies, all the disasters in a very comprehensive way. Ayushman Bharat is a bigger component that used to be taken in one session, actually one separate session to be needed. That Ayushman Bharat do have two components, one of the PMJY, which is the health insurance schemes, and second is the health and wellness centers. These health and wellness centers do have 12 packages of services, and we are putting a new health worker at the sub-center level. So that health worker is named as community health officer. And earlier we do not have a NCD penetration up to the sub-center level, but with the installment of this CHO at the sub-center, we are now focusing on the non-communicable disease part also. This is one of the waiving program Gujarat has taken as a pilot project since 2010 to 2013, and it has been scaled up across the nation under the leadership of Pradhan Mantri Narendra Modi. The free dialysis schemes are running in Gujarat since back 2009 to 2010, and IKD Hospital, that Institute of Kidney and Dialysis Unit at Ahmedabad, is giving the guidance to all the dialysis centers across the country. This one is one very critical health program in recent context. As you see, most of the dialysis disability adjusted life has happened due to the non-communicable diseases, and this NPCDCS program is critical to handle, to provide the services for community. There are different dimensions of NPCDCS. It has NCD clinics at district hospitals and CHCs. It has daycare chemotherapy centers at Damnagar, Vadodara and Rajkot. It has cardiac care units, intensive cardiac care units at Gandhinagar, Damnagar, Porbandar, Rajkot and Junagar, located at district hospitals and medical colleges. For geriatric care, we are initiating quite few steps, starting from the dedicated time for the elderly has been assigned to all government health facilities, and separate OPDs to be identified at each facility. It's just that the program is in the infant stage. We are expecting more dimension of this program over the period. Mental health. The recent attention to the mental health has come, and this program also needs to be taken up at a large scale, and scaling up is going to happen over the 2 to 3 years. NUHM setup, Institution Mechanism, that at the rural level we do have PHC of 30,000 population and 20,000 population, but at the urban level we do have facility at the 50,000 population. So at the ASHA, at rural level we do have at the 1,000 population, but at urban level at 2,000 population we do have urban ASHA. At urban level, sub-center is defined, do have a geographic area of 5,000 to 6,000 population, 5,000 to 3,000 population. But at urban level, the population is 10,000 to 12,000. Ahmedabad is the metro city. We do have 3 million plus cities, Surat, Vadodara and Rajkot. These are the district headquarters, do not have major cities, Rajkot, Lakhimpur, Vyara, Lunawar and Udaipur. So total 71 cities are covered under the NUHM. And rest of the town population, those two have less than 50,000 population, are covered under the Nagar Palika and NHF. Urban projection. Earlier we do have 25% population at urban areas in 1961. But by the 2021 we will have 45.68% population in cities. I'll go through the PIP part also, so we'll do have a discussion after that. Each of those programs what I have mentioned, that to be translated into the financial part, and the financial part of NHM do have 18 heads. These 18 heads covered with sub-budget lines, sub-activities, and each activity is to be translated into financial part. How? Let me give you the example. Let's say, for the health bond care. So at the sub-center, so that sub-center do have 100 live births over there. So in the HBNC, Asha has to visit a 6 or 7 visits to each child, and for those visits, she will get 100 rupees, 250 rupees for each child. So for the better implementation of home-based newborn care, I need to have data of my live births for the next year. So based on the estimation, I need to identify, I need to propose those amount to the NHM PIP. Based on those numbers, I need to identify my target population for the next year. So in the year 2020-21, if I do have a live births of 100 children in my sub-centered areas, then I need to have a amount of 250 rupees into 100, that's the 25,000 for implementation of home-based newborn care. So I need to map up the beneficiaries, patients, how many newborns will be born, number of ASHA in my vicinity, in my service areas, number of ANMs in my service areas. So number of conditions that to be included into the financial aspects. ASHA has to fill up the checklist, and after the filling of total checklist, I am going to give her 250 rupees at the end of the each child visits. So most of the times at the time of PIP preparation, we do prepare a district health action plan. But in Gujarat, being a progressive state, we could able to reach up to the taluka level, that taluka should have a program implementation plan. And over the next 2 years, the state will move forward and will do have a program implementation plan up to the village level. During my earlier tenure, I designed the guidelines for the all health staff, starts from the village level, ASHA to the state level, that what are the criteria to be included, to be done to prepare a program implementation plan. So those guidelines covered how to map the beneficiary, what are the target audience, what are the dimension of programs, what are the key factors to be considered while preparing a program implementation plan, what are the financial aspects to be taken into the consideration while preparing program implementation plan. So to prepare a program implementation plan, you need to have a situational analysis of your districts, of your service area, and after the situational analysis, one can prepare a program implementation plan, and those program implementation plan to be translated into the financial part, and those financial part to be converted into the 18 hits. We used to do SWOT analysis. Some of the districts do have a better capacity, so they used to conduct a log framework matrix. Some of the districts can have a quite capacity to prepare a problem tree analysis. So those way one can identify their gaps and take the help of National Health Mission to fill up those gaps. Uh,
These are the FMR course, finance management record course. So most of the programs are supported through NHM, do have financial aspects. These are the activities. So for the incentivization of ASHA, my unit measure was number of beneficiaries. For the incentives of ASHA for routine activities, my unit measure of number of ASHA. So each of the gaps to be translated into the target audience, and those target audience and those unit measures to be translated into the financial parts. Because in NHM, most of the financial norms are defined for each activity. So these are the target and quantity, what to be considered. I used to teach all the CDHOs and RCHOs that this way one can prepare a PIP and translate into the financial aspects, what we call as budget. I'll end my session here. We can move forward with the questions and answer. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. That was a wonderful presentation, a very detailed and very presentation it was. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Anyone from the panel wants to? Yeah.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir.
Why there is a better maternal indicators in Pakistan and Bangladesh as compared to India, whereas India is supposed to be standing far ahead so far as the development of these developed countries are concerned.
Sir, your voice is breaking.
Why our country is far behind than our developed countries like Pakistan and Bangladesh?
Yes, sir. That needs a quite discussion actually. I can answer in a certain way that the Bangladesh is quite progressive. So but is the Sri Lanka.
Bangladesh is not that much developed what our country is.
Yes, sir. But Bangladesh and Sri Lanka are giving 8% of GDP for the public health infrastructures. And Pakistan is struggling in a different way, that those communicable diseases are quite vibrant in Pakistan. So apart from maternal health, the morbidity and mortality are quite high in Pakistan compared to India. But yes, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka are delivering a fine example of public health, and they are focusing on dedicated health system centering concept. In India, we do have health is a state subject, and each states are doing something which is not aligned with the health system centering. They do have different kind of HR policies, different kind of infrastructure policies that are guided by less by the public health expert and more by the administrator in India. So that is quite my overview for these gaps between the countries and between the states also.
Similarly, there is a
Yes, sir. I agree with you, and I do not have quite comments on that part. That is the law is actually quite to be handled over the health part, because in the PCP and DT we do have some kind of limitation that the district do not have appropriate authority, though they were assigned by the appropriate. as for the Rajasthan, as for the Madhya Pradesh, the health CDHO do have some kind of law authority over the PCP and DT Act. State is working on that. We are working on that, the Clinical Establishment Act also. After those implementation, those support from the law, we would be able to reduce the malpractice of the private sectors and also the mindset of a community in certain way. Sir, your voice is breaking. I'm not able to hear a single word actually. Vaibhav, can you help me? Lots of noises coming from there. Sir, I'm getting lots of noise disturbance. No, sir. Vaibhav? Sir.
Yes, sir.
I'm getting quite a disturbance in noise.
Okay, let me mute.
Can you type the questions raised by Naresh, sir?
Yeah. Sure.
Yes, sir. SAM prevalence is quite high in the from the data of NFHS-4, but most of the states are having the same kind of pattern of the SAM prevalence. The ICDS actually has to play a vital role, because other than having the SAM children, the growth monitoring at the community level is quite missing. What we do have quite good examples of Jharkhand, quite good examples from the Orissa, and the country needs to replicate those examples at a wider scale, that the community capacity to be developed, rather than providing take-home rations and take-home services at the facility level. Sir, in the recent data, we used to minimize those SAM prevalence from 9 to 6.9. And this year, in the recent survey, has established that the SAM prevalence up to the 5%.
Yes, sir.
I'm getting lots of voices.
I'm
right. Tashwat, can you mute the mic?
Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So, Harsh sir, I think Godara sir wants to know more about the leprosy in the district of the leprosy program in the district of Dang.
As far as a public health expert, public health professional, the Dang district do have the earlier the problem is the manpower. Actually, we used to conduct the surveys every 2 to 3 years, and we are getting 100 leprosy patients each year. And over the period, it has been minimized, because earlier we used to get the patients of 300 to 400. And seeing a long incubation period of leprosy, we are expecting that the Dang, Navsari, and Tapi would have a less number of patients in 2020 and 2021 survey. So each year state had planned to do a house-to-house survey for the leprosy. The basic problem of the Dang is the migration. After the Holi, approximately 60% populations migrated to the urban sites, to the Surat and to the other parts of Gujarat. So the comprehensive survey has been taken place in last 2 years, and the state is affirmative actually that the reduction of leprosy would be at the elimination level in coming 2022. सर वो तो हर एक डिसीज में होता है दैट दोज आर द सिस्टम गैप्स एक्चुअली सर दोज आर द सिस्टम गैप्स वन कैन नॉट क्वांटिफाई दोज पार्ट्स एंड द डिस्कशन कैन गो ऑन एंड ऑल सेम हैपन विद द कोविड माय व्यू इज क्वाइट डिफरेंट दैट द गियरिंग अप कोविड मैनेजमेंट टू बी टेकन बाय द हेल्थ पीपल अदर देन द एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव पीपल Yes, sir.
Yeah. But are these guidelines being followed by workers and implemented
at the level? Sir, it depends on the leadership of the district, leadership of the facilities. Because the health staff need to take the advantage. So my role is mostly where the monitoring part of those guidelines to be followed. And if not, that the correction to be done at appropriate level. So if the ASHA and female health worker is not doing that part, then the PIP should be prepared by the medical officers. So each level responsibility was set. And ultimately, I used to monitor the districts. And the district has the responsibility to monitor at the field level. So what we tried to establish certain systems during the PIP. That each district to be visited over the period of 2 months and suggestions to be given to the CDHOs. That system was established. But what I tell you, sir, that the all depends on the leadership of districts.
Thank you, one and all, for attending this wonderful lecture.
Thank you, sir,
for taking your time for this wonderful
lecture. I had a couple of quick questions.
Yeah. Please, sir. Ashwat, sir.
Okay. So, Harsh, first of all, thank you very much for joining in this webinar and for an excellent session. I had a couple of quick questions. First thing which I wanted to know, or rather all the students would want to know, is that as we know that there are a large list of programs which are to be followed at the PNC level and the institutional level. So, ideally speaking, how would they be priced? Say, for example, of the attention goes into the programs with a wider coverage. But ideally, how should they be prioritized for better implementation? That's the first question. And the second thing is that you explained really well about the PIP and the concept of the budget proposal which are put up at the taluka level and then compiled at the district level and put up for each district. So is there a specific difference between the PIP which is put up by an aspirational district versus the PIP that is put up by a non-aspirational district?
Thank you, Shashwat. But I would like to hear those questions from the students itself rather than the faculty. Because that would be more helpful for the students to have those questions in their mind rather supplementing their queries. First of all, thank you, Shashwat. I would like to answer your first question in a sequential way. Those programs are included into the national health programs. They do have certain types of integration within each programs. Most of the times, we used to do interim analysis while implementing those programs through the certain aspects by monitoring of certain indicators.
But yes, there are lots of national health programs. Recently, we had calculated a different kind of reports at PHC level, and at PHC, 108 reports to be submitted at the higher authority. So that's quite a number. So the state should identify a certain types of trainings that can orient the medical officers. So SHF Roorkee has planned the induction trainings on the various aspects. Also, recently there have been trainings of public health officers of the district. So they were trained to actually visualize the concept of national health program implementation in a more broader way. So training is quite a lacking part, and the fill up those gaps for the prioritization of trainings, prioritization of health interventions that to be circulated across the Gujarat. I know if I was a medical officer, we used to run 4 to 5 programs, but now it's quite complex, and the training part to be enforced across the all health cadres, not only the medical officers, not only public frontline workers, but also CHC superintendents, also the medical college superintendents also, because there are lots of new programs and all have to be trained once a year in a more comprehensive way. So it's difficult for a newly joined medical officers, but for the experienced medical officers, they do have certain kind of ideas that the beneficiaries are same for most of the national health programs. They used to run those programs in the 30,000 populations. So I used to think earlier that the 36 national health programs at PHC level, 18 national health programs, how do they run? But after going with the PHCs, after visiting several facilities in 2016 and 17, I realized that the most experienced medical officers can manage most of the health programs, because they do know that these programs do have these beneficiaries, and most of the programs do have overlapping their interventions with the same beneficiaries. So experience and training provides a wider platform to understand national health programs. Second part, what was the second question actually?
Yeah, are you able to? Can you hear me?
What was the second? Hello?
Yes, yes. So he is having some network. Let me just. So, sir, his next sequel question was that what is exact difference between an aspirational district and a non-aspirational district CIP when we talk about the program implementation part? So, is there any difference between the two categories?
Yeah. Aspirational district Dahod and Narbda do have priorities in the NHM PIP. Just like the health and wellness centers. If I speak about the health and wellness centers, the aspirational districts to be saturated first than the other districts. So, for the health and wellness center to saturate all the sub-centers within aspirational districts, we need to provide more funding, more manpower to those districts. We do have proposals which includes innovation within these districts. Like the in Labda, we used to have boat ferry for providing services to the island populations. So we had proposed into the PIP, and now district has taken in their way. The construction part of health facilities are prioritized for the aspirational districts, for the high priority districts. Same way, manpower would get higher incentives in aspiration districts to the NHM. So, if one of the surgeon wants to join, one of the gynecologists wants to join, in aspiration district at Sagwad and Ediyappada at the Limkheda and Garbada. So they will get more than 2 lakhs of monthly salary than the normal 1.2 lakh salary at the normal districts. So this way, man, material, machines are being prioritized in the aspiration districts, and they do have some kind of weightage in the PIP. They do have some kind of conditions that to be met in the NHM PIP.
Okay.
I hope I'm able to justify the answer. Justify the questions.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for your response.
Yeah. So thank you. Thank you so much. That was a wonderful webinar. Thank you again, Harsh, for sparing your time. Just a small token of gratitude from our institute, and I would like to present this small certificate for your.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, so thank you again to all of you for joining this meeting. Thank you.